I'm coming up to the end of my first 3 months as chief ecologist for Ecotalk, and we've got so much done. We've made an amazing difference on the sites that we've got for UK wildlife. We've got machinery digging ditches. We've got beavers coming in. We've got the fences going up. We've got the trees coming down. We've got the ponds going in. We are really out there repairing, restoring and rewilding for the UK. It's about making a difference for all of this beautiful life. Chris, it's a busy day in Bowyer's Wood today. Lots of activity. What's going on?
What's going on is, long last, we're putting up the beaver fence.
Long last?
Yes, it's 2 years to get a licence.
2 years to get a licence to do some proper rewilding. What nonsense that is. Anyway, it's all behind us because now we're in action. And it's the fence going up. Tell me a bit about the fence.
Well, the fence will be, it's very specific wire. It's built in such a way, and it has to be designed in such a way that the beavers aren't going to get out. So instead of what you're probably used to with either a stock fence or a deer fence, it'll come right down to the ground and there'll be a skirt.
Okay.
It goes into the enclosure.
Yeah.
And that'll be buried and that will discourage the beavers from trying to get out.
So if they go up to the fence and start digging there, they'll and dig down, they'll come in, there'll be more wire there which will stop them getting out.
They'll hit the skirt at the bottom.
Excellent.
And we have to do this to Natural England's specification.
Okay. And what about the size of the enclosure and the length of the fence?
It's about a kilometre of fence.
A kilometre of fence?
A kilometre of fence, 20 acres, something like that.
20 acres. Just down here, probably 50, 60 metres away, is the all-important stream. Beavers need water, so don't think we're just releasing them into a bramble patch. There's a stream down there, which will be modified by the beavers. And the other thing that we've looked at is the amount of food for them. These animals eat the bark of trees, which is why they foul those trees alongside those streams. And, of course, we've seen them at Downer Kerry. We've got beavers already at Downer Kerry, and we've seen them loving that little stream there. So they don't need massive rivers. So what we're talking about here are ecosystem engineers. Beavers don't just come in and do their own thing. They reshape the entire environment and in doing so offer resources for a whole range of different species. And what we see is that when beavers are established in a site like this, you get a greater number of invertebrates to start with because you get all of those creatures that can live in the water. Damselflies, dragonflies, water beetles, tadpoles, and then you get the amphibians which emerge from those, and then you get the reptiles that eat the amphibians, and on top of everything you get all the birds. So you see a massive increase in biodiversity when you get beavers into an area.
Yeah, that's really what we're hoping for, because it's we're sort of sacrificing a bit of woodland that has been messed about in the past, and what we're really hoping for is to go for some sort of wetland-woodland mixture. And there are already the components there, the willows, bit of alder, for that.
And whilst it looks like we're doing all the work today because we've got some relatively heavy machinery here, and to be honest with you, this is the light touch. The beavers are going to move in here and do all of the work for us. And the best bit of that is that you don't have to pay them with anything but bark. And we've got lots of bark. I'm very excited to be here today with another brilliant conservationist, the one and only Jimmy Hill from Raptor Aid. I don't, you know, choose my words lightly. We only work with the best at Ecotalk. Derek Gowan, of course, Jimmy. So good to see you, mate.
Pleasure, Chris.
So tell us a little bit about the work that you do, because you're renowned, obviously, for your raptor expertise. You and I have been up and down trees doing some pretty exciting stuff.
Yeah, so I'm probably pigeonholed myself a little bit. I tend to specialise in birds of prey. I'm well aware that everything else is important, and I see that here at the woodland here. But yeah, my background is practical conservation. So I do a lot of work volunteering for the British Trust for Ornithology. So nest records, ringing, monitoring, understanding how British birds of prey are faring, basically.
And Raptor Aid produces boxes. I've got five of them in my garden. Tawny owls have been loving them, thank you very much. Okay, well, look, we're here today to put up this box, which is a barn owl box. Talk us through this, because it's actually a lot more complex than people might imagine. Look, when we first started putting these things up, we used to get tea chests and stick them up in barns. I mean, they worked, but this has been refined, hasn't it?
Yeah, absolutely. I think it's about finding a balance between what is cost-effective, what's environmentally friendly, and also ultimately what works for the birds. So ultimately what the barn owl in this case is looking for is a cavity. We've lost, you know, a lot of trees, a lot of ancient woodland that would have naturally provided those cavities. Of course, people also say, well, a barn owl, they should be living in a barn. But they're a bird of open countryside, open grassland, and a lot of these barns have been developed. So barn owl boxes have really, really come to the fore for this species in terms of conservation success in the UK.
I've heard that half the barn owls that are nesting in the UK are now in boxes that conservationists like yourself have put up for them.
Yeah, absolutely. So I think one of the figures is 4 out of 5 breeding pairs of barn owls is in a nest box. So this box here, this is a standard, what we call a standard A-frame barn owl box. So the design is, it's made out of wood. Some of them nowadays are coming made out of recycled plastic. But essentially what you want for a barn owl box is the shape is actually, I think it was probably came off the fact that they once did nest in barns. So it's that apex of a building design. Right. But why it really works is because the owls are going to be down here at the bottom of this box here. And there's a big floor space. Barn owls can have up to, you know, 6-7 chicks in a really good vole year. They actually stay in the box for a long time. So barn owls don't, strictly speaking, fledge until they're 60-65 days old. So 2 months, they're pretty much fully grown barn owls and they fledge. So that is going to take up a lot of space. Mm-hmm. So you want the space. Also, what you want is the height difference from the entrance hole there to down here. Because unfortunately, a little bit different to tawny owls, if a barn owl chick were able to get out of the box, if the hole was down here, for instance, and fall onto the floor, sadly, the parent barn owls will just carry on provisioning the box and they'll ignore the chick on the floor. They're not like tawny owls where they will branch and the adults will provision for them around the woodland. So the idea of this height here is that the chicks can't get up onto this ledge until they're 60-65 days old.
That's what the ledge is about. The ledge is about a perching place for the adults, obviously, when they're bringing the food in. That helps. And also, when the young finally do get out here, they've got that opportunity to sort of suss out the world before they take the first big leap into the wider bit.
Absolutely, yeah. And one of the other things I look at when we're picking trees for this, obviously, we want a nice, clear flight path into the box.
And I should say that's why we've taken these branches down here, because they need to be able to swoop beneath these other branches.
Yeah, and they need to be able to find their box, but we have left a decent sized limb in front of the box with a view that the male, when he's provisioning the chicks, and the female and the chicks when they come to fledge, have got somewhere that they can go onto, and as you say, they can watch the world go by ready for their maiden flights.
We're going to put some sort of peat alternative in there, something like that, some soil.
So this is my top secret that I see so many people don't do this, and I do it all the time. There's some lovely molehill soil out there.
Yep.
Absolutely. So owls don't build their own nests, as you're aware. So what they would naturally do is a barn owl would hopefully take up residence here, and they'll regurgitate the pellets, and that becomes the matter in the box. I like to give them a helping hand, because if there's a barn owl passing, you know, and they come into this box and they see that there's already some materials in the bottom of the box, they can lay their eggs on it. So that's exactly what they do. They'll add their own with the pellets, but yeah, it's to give them a head start.
Yeah, I always get a load of leaf litter, some soil, like you say, something like that to chuck down in the bottom there.
Yeah, it doesn't hurt. I see so many people who don't do it, and I think it's just gives them that little head start.
Yeah, it's like putting a carpet down. That's pretty obviously. Who wants to go into a house with a concrete floor?
Exactly.
Okay, and so then obviously the reason that we've got the door here is to allow us to access if we want to ring the birds, monitor them in any way.
Yeah, and maintain the box as well. So this is a thing that a lot of people don't do. I mean, it's great. The principal thing is putting boxes up for wildlife. That is great, but they do need some care and attention. Now, obviously, I need to point out the barn owls are a Schedule 1 species, so they're protected by law in the breeding season, so you need a specific licence to interfere and disturb them during the breeding season. But absolutely, in the winter months, as we've already talked about, you'll get squirrels, jackdaws. They will add leaves and twigs and stuff. And the box then can get full right up. I've seen in the space of 6 months a squirrel fill a box this big with leaves. And of course, if a barn owl does then nest on it, it makes this gap absolutely devoid and worthless. So yeah, it is handy to be able to get up, get into the box and clean it and maintain it.
And if people are lucky enough to have perhaps a property with a garden that looks out over an open field like this, this is something, I mean, they're relatively inexpensive. Get some expert help, make sure you don't fall off the ladder. It's a great way of getting proactively involved in conservation, isn't it?
Yeah, as I say at the start, the proof is in the pudding, really. We know that boxes like this for barn owls have had a huge success on the species. So if you've got the right habitat, then yeah, it's a no-brainer to put a box up.
Okay, let's put a box up. I'll give you a hand.
Right. I just need to do a quick little bit of prep. There's your lid.
Ready.
So we're good to go. So I'll, if I lift it off,
yeah,
and then...
And then you hold it, I'll go around and take the slack.
Yeah.
All right then. You ready?
What's our drill?
Yep.
Okay. Yep.
Okay, you got that?
Yeah. You okay with that, Chris? Oh, you do that. So I'll come round there. Yeah.
Come here.
Just lower it down a bit, Chris. A bit more. Just a smidge more. That'll do. Hold it there.
Make sure it's straight, Jimmy. I can't bear a wonky nest box.
Exactly.
I don't want a box where all the eggs are going to roll down into one corner.
Okay, Chris, just
is it on?
Yeah, just let the slack off a little. Right, if you pull that.
Right, hold on a minute. I'm going to be the purveyor of fine dirt.
Thank you very much.
Shall I do it?
It's all yours.
Thank you. I name this box Taito, in honour of the birds that will nest in her. God bless this box. Well, it's up.
It's up.
It's up. Up. Look at that. Oh, that's so good, isn't it? So good.
Yeah.
What do you think?
Yeah, it's absolutely spot on. And hopefully come May, we'll have a female will occupy it.
Look at that. Perfect flight in.
Yep.
Branch for the young and for the adults perching outside.
Yep.
Facing out into the field, which is becoming rougher by the day because we've got no sheep in here any longer and we're not going to be harrowing it. Oh, I can feel the voles out there shivering in fear of the owls which will arrive.
Yes. Good work.
Thank you, mate.
Pleasure.
We're very excited because we're doing a bit of soft edging. Basically, we've got these hard lines where we previously had fences. And what we want to do is move the woodland and scrub out into the field. That's the plan, isn't it?
That's it. We're basically replicating what's naturally happening because the willow on the edge of the wood is doing what it's designed to do, which is to fall over. Crack and go again, and we've got one piece that's dead, and on the other side of that coppice stool there's one that's alive, so we're just speeding up the process, really. So cutting some trees forward, making a bit of an edge where birds can appear, and just creating a rough edge also to this just to discourage a deer a little bit.
Yeah, because we've got to be clear, we're not going to cut these up. We're leaving them as they are.
As they are.
And they make, like this one, like a natural cage.
Yeah.
Where the deer and other herbivores can't get in.
Yeah.
All your plants, bramble and everything else will establish here. Right, I'm here with Grace. And you've been using the camera traps out here at Bowyer's Wood to see what's been around.
I have, since our brilliant masterclass together.
Okay, well, a little bit of a recap. So these are cameras that you set up out in the woods. They've got a lens here and a little motion sensor here so that anything that moves past them triggers them and you get a 30-second shot. And they even work at night because they've got these infrared lights here. And how many have you had out?
We've had five out across the site.
Five out across the site. And of course, the benefit is that they monitor that site for 24 hours a day, non-intrusively. You don't have to be there. They just sit there and they trigger when something moves by. The question is, what's been moving by?
Well, lots of things.
You've been peeping.
I have been peeping.
You've been peeping.
I couldn't wait.
Okay. Well, look, the first thing we've got here is a lovely deer. Oh, that is absolutely fantastic, isn't it?
It's gorgeous.
Hey, right in front of the camera.
Yeah.
Fallow deer, obviously a female, lacking in antlers. Did you pay her some sort of, I don't know, forage to pose?
No peanuts yet.
No peanuts yet. That was absolutely brilliant. Let's scroll down and see what else we've got. Well, that's nice, a single badger.
It's lovely. There's his set there.
Yeah. And if you get lots of images of badgers that are set like that, you will be able to learn how to tell them apart.
I was thinking that.
Yeah. So firstly, they're relatively easy to sex. So an animal which is longer and more slender and has a longer tail, like that one, is a female, a sow. And those which are more robust, particularly around the jaws, around the face, chunky face, if you get a good head on, then that's the boar, the male.
Okay, brilliant.
So that's
good to know.
Yeah, if you just take another look at that. You see, as she walks past there, that's got quite a long, narrow tail. Well, I'm thinking that that's it's an adult female. It's not one of this year's cubs. It's an adult female. So then the next thing to do is to look at any little patterns on her body. So sometimes where they fight, they lose a bit of an ear, have a scar on the nose, and things like that. And that does now enable you to know them as individuals. So
the quality on these is brilliant. You can actually, differentiate those things.
It's so good, isn't it?
Wow.
It's nice, isn't
it? Yeah.
Fallow deer, you see they've got the white and then the black down the...
beautiful markings.
I think you might be winning the Ecotalk Fallow Deer Award.
I think we might be, yeah.
That's nice though. Look, way in the frame, pin sharp, browsing away.
Yes, great to see.
I think you've been blessed with beginner's luck, if I'm honest with you. I mean,
look, wow, it's just incredible. Wow.
Fallow buck right in front of the camera. Look at the animal
cutting his ear.
Yes, yes. You're right. You'd be able to spot that one again. And of course,
brilliant.
It's coming up to that time of year when they're going to be rutting.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah.
Soon you'll be able to hear them when you're out.
And that's it. It stops at 20 seconds.
Yeah, I think change it to 30 seconds.
Absolutely. I want to see some more.
Days would be good. And also, of course, ideally, now we've got fallow, roe, badger, robin. You've had squirrel.
Yeah.
Any foxes?
One fox.
One fox. It would be great to turn up some other creatures as well.
It really would be.
Maybe polecat. Try the river.
Yes.
Otter. You never
know. I've scouted out some good spots for the next one.
Excellent. And then the real prize, I have to say, which would be very tricky, would be dormice.
Oh, wow.
And given all the hazel here, and given the sweet chestnut, and given the density of the woodland, it's not beyond the bounds of possibility.
No.
If you've got one, so I'd give you the camera trap of the year. Or, you know,
I'm up for it. I'm up for the challenge.
You've done brilliantly, Grace. I've got to tell you, they're really, really good, aren't they?
Yeah, they are. They're amazing. Thank you.